I greet you in the name of the one who calls himself the Amen, the one who holds the keys of David, the one who opens and none can shut, and the one who shuts and none can open, namely the Lord Jesus Christ. At this time, we have seen the devastation that Corona has wreaked upon the earth, and how that even some among us internationally have gone home. But we thank God for those who remain, that signifying that you all still have a part to play. My title this morning is going to be Rehearsal. Rehearsal, and my scripture readings are two, and they come from the book of Matthew. The first one is Matthew 5:14. Ye are the light of the world, a city that is set on an hill cannot be hid. I want you to notice what he calls you. Not only does he call you the light of the world, he also hints that you are a city. Later in Revelation 21, he will show you where the angel invites John. John is a symbol of the bride. And he says, come, I will show you that city. I will show you the bride. So there's an interplay between the city and the bride and the city. You are the light, and a city on a hill cannot hide or cannot be hidden. We do believe there will be a physical city that will shoot up from underneath the earth, and the other part comes from above. Our second scripture reading is Matthew 16:28. This one I want for you to mark carefully. In verse 27, because it's linked, he says, for the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, semicolon, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. Verily I say unto you, watch this promise. There be some standing here. And we know later in the next chapter, he took Peter, James, and John. There be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Now, why do I take the title Rehearsal? I am taking it from the prophet of the hour when he preached about this very scripture, Matthew 16:28. He said he took Peter, James, and John for the rehearsal. I will give you the quote as we go along. Now, when Jesus in Matthew 5:14 was speaking of a city on a hill, our Lord Jesus was a practical preacher, though very deep. When he preached about the wheat, he would point to a field. When he preached about a city on the hill, he was pointing to a city today that's called Safed, and our technicians will spell it for you on the screen. S-A-F-E-D, Safed. It is by the Sea of Galilee. It is north of Jerusalem. Now, this city is very important till today. It's a city of rabbis and priests, like Jerusalem. Please notice a quotation from 1963, 12:26. It's conduct order doctrine. And you have these code words, exact phrase, most successful speaker or speakers. Most successful speakers, and you'll read where the prophet says, most successful speakers are like Jesus, a man of few words, people who go straight to the point in their sermons. Not take the congregation round and round and round, 40 years in the wilderness, until some of them perish, even in their very seats. Now in Psalms 78:15, which you will read with me on the screen, I like this line. He let them drink out of the great depth. That word drink out of the great depth is a challenge to the believer today, and especially to the ministries that are in the fivefold. Because 1 Corinthians 10:4 also says, for that rock was Christ. You see, Jesus Christ is our great depth. Here is a quotation to back it up. 1963:08:25, perfect faith. The key words are, teach a little deeper, rub unbelief out. Here the prophet indicates that in instances where there is still a lot of unbelief roaming around in assembly, the minister can also apply this technique. Teach a little deeper thing to rub some of this make-believe out. Now, I want to address, there be some standing here who shall not taste of death. Matthew 16:28. Notice that the very next chapter is chapter 17:1. And as we read it together, our technicians will put it up before you, but I want to emphasize that it follows exactly the statement and the promise, there be some standing here who shall not taste of death. In Matthew 17:1, watch as I emphasize, and after 6 days, 6 days after he made the promise, some of you standing here will not taste of death. He takes Peter, James, and John, his brother, watch, and brings them up into a high mountain, not joined to the others, high mountain apart. It is going to be important to note that some scholars think that the transfiguration took place at Mount Hermon. I'll give you the scriptures. Deuteronomy 3:1. But Mount Hermon is very up north at the border of Israel and Syria, and so says the scripture. But if you note Matthew 17, it says, after 6 days. Meaning, when he made the promise of Matthew 16:28, they were in the area of Mount Hermon. I agree. But Matthew 17:1 tells you that he traveled 6 days from Mount Hermon. So where did he travel to? he was headed to what we call Mount Transfiguration. And if you want the scripture, it is Jeremiah 46, 18. And you will read it with me. And it will tell you that there is a Mount Carmel by the sea, Mediterranean, and there's Mount Tabor, Tavor in Hebrew, T-A-V-O-R, our English T-A-B-O-R, but in Matthew we call it Mount Transfiguration. And the reason why the scripture says a mountain apart, it was to distinguish it from Mount Hermon, because Mount Hermon is a continuation of mountains. It is conjoined to other mountains, Mount Hermon. But Mount Tabor stands in its own and stands apart. And our technician, Brother Michael, who has been to Israel with me, will project the picture of Mount Tabor. Tabor in Hebrew signifies belly button, muhuba. Indeed, Mount Tabor or Tabor stands out like a pimple on your skin or your navel on your stomach. And it is apart from the other mountains. Scripture is so precise. Therefore, Mount Hermon, as we've indicated, is north of Israel near Syria, but Mount Tabor or Mount Transfiguration is near Nazareth. But I want to come back to the Jeremiah 46, 18. It says, as Mount Tabor is among the mountains, standing on its own, but it's among the other mountains of the land of Israel. Someday, when you come along with us, we will take an hour or so over there in the land of Israel and identify to you the other mountains, among which is Mount Tabor. I want you to notice the rehearsal. If you are a careful listener, we are going to run through five major points. We are going to show you, as we've opened with the scripture, that when Jesus was pointing to a mountain near the Sea of Galilee, Safed, which at night in the days of Jesus was the only city in that area that had home lights burning up on the hill, when everything else was pitch dark, there would be lights burning on the hill. And he used that as a rehearsal of the new city to come. The new city, that will be like a hill, and the lamb at the top will be the light thereof. So Matthew 5 and 14 was a rehearsal before Revelation 21. Then the Lord Jesus came to Matthew 17 and he did the same rehearsal. He left the other disciples at the bottom, there's your bottom pyramid. Then he took Peter, James, and John, he's coming into the headstone. And then the Lord Jesus was transfigured above them. There's your complete pyramid. There's your other city. Like a hill whose light is at the top. Then as we move along, we come to 2 Peter chapter 1. We see a mystery of the pyramid, which our technicians are going to project before you, with faith, virtue, knowledge, coming all the way up to brotherly kindness. Then there's a chasm. There is a bridge. city, and you are part of it with those seven virtues in you? Which seven virtues must be kept by the headstone, the headship, the Lord Jesus Christ? Then we are going to take you to our modern day end time vindicated prophet, the one and only that God approved in this hour. How that he says the angels picked me up and he himself was at Sunset Mountain. And right above him, the cloud came with that light on the right side of the picture, which the technicians will project. But below that, the prophet had been there with some brethren. Sunset Mountain, a repeat of Matthew 17 in our day. And may I not forget to remind you that the prophet Moses went through the very same experience. He came to Sinai. He left the rest of the elders below. He ascended up the mountain. And then up on the mountain, the pillar of fire met him. There is another rehearsal. And we've seen it repeat in the life of our beloved prophet. Then there's going to be Matthew 21. But before we get to Matthew 21, I will not fail to show you how the Lord Jesus spoke of you as the individual. I'll come to that. I will not fail to share with you the quote in 1962 where the prophet said, kept the pyramid of our lives. We are also another mountain. We are also a mountain that needs to peak at the top as believers. But let me draw back a little bit and run it through the scriptures. You see, the parable of the prodigal son takes me 4 hours to preach the mystery of the seventh seal, the coming mystery coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, the body preparation of the bride, the body change, the going into the wedding supper, the appearance of the two witnesses, the father slipping out of the wedding feast to implore his elder son Israel. It's all hidden in the parable of the prodigal son, which we at the Willows have preached, and we've sat under these things for the glory of God. But allow me this morning to take you through the letter R. And the technicians are going to put the letter R in big, bold letters before you. And under that R, they'll say one. The prodigal son had a resolution to make. Resolution is the word I want on the screen. Number two. How he took his reward before time. Reward, number two. Number three, how he went away and squandered his inheritance, put the word retrogression. His life began to fall back. Then number four, he came to realization. Number five, he had to make a resolve. I shall arise. Number six, he then made the return, the journey that I call the return. Then number seven, we see the restoration. Restoration, number seven, when his father receives him. When the prophet says, Christ kissed away our past. Then watch number eight. The redressing. They had to dress him all over again before he entered into the feast. As for the light on the hill and the new city to come, the prophet took about 3 hours to preach it in the Future Home message. I will not take 3 hours, since you can go back and play the tape, the restoration, rather the Future Home of the heavenly bridegroom and the earthly bride, and together with it, read Revelation 21. Folks, let's embark upon the mysteries and the drinking that is deep. Have you noticed that Matthew 17:1 says, after 6 days? What does that tell you? It was on the seventh day then. God so timed it that when they left the area of Caesarea Philippi, Barnabas today, walking from village to village, 6 days passed, and on the seventh, after 6 days, they arrived in the area of Nazareth, Mount Tabor. You can preach the seven changes right there, because now he's going to be glorified. The cloud is going to overshadow him. His face is going to shine like the sun on the seventh day on Mount Tabor. You know what? Peter, James, and John were then taken as the three, almost like to form a pyramid. One on this side, one on this side, and one on top, and he was glorified over. These things are deep. But now we come to another scripture, and at this scripture I want to pause. It's Luke 9:28. Luke 9:28. This scripture is going to repeat the very Matthew 17. But listen, read carefully. Luke 9:28. And it came to pass about an 8 days. Not on the eighth day, approximately on the eighth day. After these things, sayings. What sayings? There be some standing here who shall not die. He took Peter, James, and John, and went up into an high, or rather into a mountain to pray. Luke does not say high mountain. Matthew this time, a man who was trained under Roman office work, tax collector, he hit it on the nail when he said a mountain apart. Matthew says after 6 days. Luke says approximately on the eighth day. Beautiful, beautiful. Because seven and eight are fused today. Seven is completion, it's the end. Eight is the beginning of a new system. But here is another nugget. If Luke says about, approximately on the eighth day, he's indicating that the event of the transfiguration happened toward the evening of the seventh day. Hallelujah! And that is exactly where we are, folks. There shall be light in the evening time. The path to glory we shall surely find. Oh my! I am so excited for these things. The rehearsal. Now, let me take you back to our day. And you go to the tape 6508:15. and knoweth it not. I am particularly interested for you to read from paragraph 274 to 278. It's too long for us to put on the screen. But here are the key words I'm looking for. Roy, for Brother Roy Robeson. Roy, raking with a rake. Raking white cloud. Pecked. P-A-C-K-E-D. Roy, raking white cloud. Pecked. Brother Roy Robeson's dream. Brother Branham, we're sitting like in Palestine. You look snow white. There we go. And as we were sitting, a cloud came and pepped you away. And when the prophet interprets that dream, he links the cloud to his pyramid teaching. But notice how the dream said, like Moses. You see, these rehearsals have been coming through from the beginning of scripture right up to the end. Moses, Mount Sinai. Jesus, Mount Tabor table. The prophet of the hour, Mount Sunset. You, spiritual mountain housetop, will give you the scripture. Then as we move along, there we end up in Revelation 21. There's another mountain top that's going to shoot up from below and the headstone above. You know what? The prophet says, the angels pecked me away. Here is a short quotation. 65:04:18. It is the rising of the sun. The words are foreordained. One word. Bride. Wave. Sheaf. There the prophet indicates that his being taken into the cloud was like God inspecting his field of wheat, including all of us. And as God inspected, hallelujah, the field of harvest in our day, one man was matured ahead of time. God waved that sheaf as the priest in Leviticus 23, as a sign that the rest of us who follow that same message will come to the same ripening. Indeed, folks, when he took him up into that cloud, Sunset Mountain, it was like God calling Moses to the top of Mount Sinai. Folks, here is the scripture I want to take my time on, and the technicians are going to put it up for you to read. And then after we read, they're going to tabulate seven things that I find in that scripture. Here's the scripture, Psalms 16:15. In the light of the king's countenance, that is life, his cloud is as the latter rain. There's a favor there. And his cloud is as the latter rain. Surely, if you have sat long enough under these end time tapes, and you have been reading your Bible carefully, you will see the cloud of 1963. If they project it again, I don't mind. There is that cloud of the latter rain. Look inside. There is the face. Whose face is it? King Theophany Jesus. When you see a cloud appear in the west, what do you expect? Rain. So what's this cloud of 1963 all about? God's favor to you. Now you'll understand why Satan is attacking this cloud like never before. Because if you have missed it and your preachers haven't emphasized it to you, Satan knows that if he takes away that cloud, you are finished. But thank God, for God called ministers, and they are everywhere on the face of the earth, who are doing their best and laboring to draw the attention of message, true message believers, to the things that the prophet preached. Folks, great speakers are those who speak very short. Allow me to repeat, because some people learn by repetition, not vain repetition. God repeats too when he says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you," there is vain repetition and there's profitable repetition. May I repeat that Moses, when he went up Mount Sinai, does not the scripture say when Moses came down, his face shone and glowed until they had to put a veil over his face? And the technicians will put up that scripture for you. Moses goes up the mountain, meets the cloud. Something happens to his face. Jesus Christ, our Lord, our number one, the principal theme of our worship, all our songs are around him. We live and die for him, our Lord Jesus Christ. He goes up a mountain. Notice, same thing. Something happens to his face. It shines as and even brighter than the sun. Can't you see? Deuteronomy 18:18. Then, my brothers, I want you to pause and listen to the testimony of Brother Roy Robeson. He says, when the prophet came from Sunset Mountain, 1963, before beginning the series on those seven seals, he was preparing the parking lot together with other brothers. He was raking the place for the parking lot. He says, when the prophet appeared, he says his face had a glow. What is he saying? This is the very same Brother Roy who dreamt that the prophet was Snow White, sitting at a table in Palestine. Same repetition. Cloud. Face changing. You know what, folks? I don't want you to miss this. That the bride is also a mysterious city. And that you can read in Revelation 21, verse 9 and 10. Come, John, I will show you the bride. And then when John looks, he sees a city. Surely you can see that link, that there is a metaphor. There's a mystery link of natural city to spiritual city, the bride and her bridegroom. But you know what? When Jesus said there be some standing here, I want to emphasize that as I give you the quote. 1960. 12, 31, Revelation chapter 4. The key words are exact phrase, they seen, S-E-E-N, they seen the rehearsal of it. But I want to emphasize the words, some, not all, standing here will not die. Do you realize that this promise is running currently? Some believers are going home, and I envy them. Why? Because they rest from their labors. They wait in their theophanies. No more battles, no more trials, no more Satan. But why are you and I still here? We have a duty to perform. But we don't know who among us are going to cross over and who among us are the some standing here who shall not taste death. Do you read me? Some among us will live up to the body change. Lord, have mercy. I would like to be among those that live up to the body change. Nevertheless, not my will, thine be done. Now I want the technicians to put side by side on the screen these two scriptures. Matthew 24, 17. Next to it, Luke 17, 31. And I want to pause for about 10 seconds while you read those two verses. Those two scriptures, if you read them quickly and carelessly, they sound like it's a repeat of the same. No, 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 no. The sounding of it, but it's the placing of it that is important. Are you ready? The Matthew 24 one was when he warned the Jews that after they reject him, Titus would come and destroy the city, and it would be winter time. And winter time in the land of Israel, the roads are impassable, not impossible, impassable. You can't travel the roads. Snow everywhere. He was warning them, Titus is coming for you in winter. But look at Luke 17, 31. It follows, and the technicians are going to put up the verse. It follows verse 30 of Luke 17. Son of man being revealed in that day, our day. After Jesus speaks of the Son of Man revealed in Luke 17, 30, in 31, he speaks to the last day believers. He is indicating that messenger will have taken you to your house top, pyramid house top. That messenger will have taken you to the house top, the headstone. Glory be to God. He says, don't come down from there. Then my question is going to be, if all those who went to their mountain tops had their faces change and glow, shine and sparkle, if you are on this, your mountain top, after you have heard this messenger of Luke 17, 30, a Son of Man, revealing the Son of Man, why do we walk around with defeated faces all the time? Why are we dejected? Why do we look depressed? We ought to, if we have come into that headship, those seven thunders, we have to have this joy, the glory of the Lord exuding and protruding and showing in our faces. I love that. It's worthy of repeat. Matthew 24, he was warning them of AD 70, 70. Titus is coming for you, and it'll be winter time, and he will butcher you. But Luke 17, he then ties the Son of Man ministry returning. Verse 30, when the Son of Man is revealed, somebody must reveal that Son of Man, and we know who that was, WMB. Then verse 31, message believer, you've climbed up your mountain. We've given you the quote in the previous series of punctuations. How the prophet says, people, he saw them coming from everywhere. Christ is revealed in his own word, and they were coming into this headship, headstone, where Christ was being revealed. We are there now. I hope you all are. Now, don't come down. How so? Look at all that's happening on social media against this message. Look how many people have jumped out of the housetop. You know what I mean. Others have put themselves as deities. Oh, my goodness, have mercy. But you... stay in your mountaintop. You know why? Because we revisit Matthew 5:14. You, the mountaintop. He said, you are the light of the world. There you go. As Christ is the light over the church, the bride, now you go out there in the dark world. Let's go find that last sheep. And when people are in darkness, there's nothing that draws a person's attention more than light shining somewhere. That's why in the message, Way of a True Prophet, he says, when this messenger of Malachi 4 comes, you can punch the exact words, blast a hole in the wall. He says, people will be trapped in their dark denominational prisons. But this Malachi 4 will blow a hole. And when that hole opens up, light shafts come in. Those in the dark are attracted by that light. He says they will come out. For the scripture said in Revelation 18, come out from among them, my people. I think it's verse 4. Of Revelation 18. I stand to be correct. Come out. Follow this light, the end time light. Folks, I have spoken to you for about 40 minutes. And I'm sure that the message is clear and straight to the point. But I leave you with this. The rehearsal. Right now, as I'm sitting here, hoping to connect with you physically someday, when flights and lockdowns are lifted, we don't know what lays in the future. There is something building up in the country of the West. We see a woman, and she's said to be the first woman of color to ascend up to this post, to run as a vice president of the United States. We don't know what it will be, the results, but I want to leave you with this question. Is that vision that was paused being revived? Could it be, folks? I don't know. Could it be a rehearsal of that vision that the prophet saw? And if you please, I'm going to leave you with the quote. I don't say it is. I'm saying, could it be? We close with a quote. Woman, precedent, order. A quote comes up, 1955-0501. This quote has jumped at me like no other quote before. Watch the words. Or in that order. Is this that we see, perhaps, that order of the vision? We will wait. And I'll come back to you with some more notes. This time, we will wait because the interpretation, the manifestation is the interpretation. We will wait and see, but surely there is excitement around the world as the little bride looks again and says, Lord, is this it? Because I leave you with these words. If, and I say again because we've got malicious people around, I said again, if, and I say for the third time, if they win and she comes in as vice president, the Lord has already showed me an order that the president, wherever they will be with the vice president, the woman, will always use the gesture, ladies first. I say for the third time, if, God bless you. Shalom Aleichem. The Lord be with you till next time.